So welcome to the Siemens 3D IC podcast series, where we dive into the exciting world of semiconductor, chiplet integration, and advanced technology platforms using 2.5 and 3D techniques brought to you by the Siemens Thought Leadership Team. I'm your host, John McMillan. In this podcast series, I talk with industry leaders and subject matter experts to discuss the latest on 3D IC chiplet ecosystems, industry trends, and roadmaps. In today's podcast, we're going to talk about creating test vehicles and daisy chain design tests for semiconductor designs. And I'm excited to welcome my guest, Kendall Hiles, a senior 3D IC pod product specialist at Siemens EDA. And I'm also excited that we're able to meet face-to-face and have our first video recording here in this wonderful studio. So thanks for being here.
Thank you, John.
And before we get started, why don't you give everyone some insights on your background and what you've been doing at Siemens EDA?
Well, I've been in EDA for, I've been married for 40 years. So for 40 years, I've been in EDA.
Married to EDA.
Started off working for a defense contractor and stuff like that. And then we used, at the time, the Mentor Graphics tools, and I ended up being an applications engineer for Mentor Graphics for about 27 years right now. And the amazing thing is I've worked for the same person for 27 years, Mike Walsh. So
I've had Mike on this podcast.
Yeah. Mike's been in it. We got into basically the 3D IC stuff probably about 20 years ago. So, working with the customer and they needed solutions to some things they were doing on. So I've been working with the IC packaging side of it for going on 20 years.
I kind of mentioned we're going to dive a little bit into the test vehicles and the daisy chain design. What is a test vehicle for starters?
So a test vehicle, unlike a product, where a product you're actually making it to sell or to do something, what a test vehicle is you're making a test bed to test something in the manufacturing process, be it the bumps and balls, connections. Maybe you want a new technology, like running on organic at 9 micron widths. Something that typically you wouldn't do on an organic material, like nobody signs off on it, but you've got something that you need, you need to go down and you need to push technology. Well, before you spend millions of dollars on something and make a product, you want to make sure that the product that you make can actually be manufactured. So that's where the test vehicles come in. And it can be a number of things, any type of new technology. You want to make a test vehicle for it to test out for the reliability and manufacturability of that product.
Gotcha. So at what points, when is a test vehicle needed?
Anytime something changes inside the manufacturing space. So I had a customer, they make these fancy glasses that have like little cameras in the temples. Well, in that 3D IC that they have in the temple, they have an embedded chip inside the laminate itself. So you've got this embedded chip in here. So before you go make millions of those, let's go make sure that we can, make the cavity, put the chip in the cavity. We have connectivity and everything else, so that they're testing out the manufacturing process before you commit to the full product and say, hey, we're going to make these. Because once you're in production and everybody's expecting you to have a product, if you have a delay, that hurts you more than coming to market a little bit late with something, not having the availability to ship.
Sounds like you described maybe a digital twin of something to see it functionally digitally before you have it manufactured.
Let's talk about what a test vehicle actually does, so we can understand it. If you have a let's just say it's a flip chip device. Mm-hmm. So you're just flipping a chip and put it on a die. You might have, the corner bumps as they get heated and everything else, you're going to expect them to crack. Okay. Your manufacturer, whoever's manufacturing it, they'll say, we can guarantee this up to like an 80,000 pin chip. You just got 100,000 pin chip that you're putting out. How many of those corner bumps are going to crack? So the way we do it is on the substrate itself, like from pin 1 to pin 2, you have a connection on the substrate. From pin 2 to pin 3, the connection's on the die. 3 to 4 substrate, 4 to 5 is die. Mm-hmm. So it's literally a chain going through each one of these bumps and balls. And at the end of the chain, you bring that out to the BGA, and that goes out to your tester. So you can chain up everything inside of here. And typically, you wouldn't do one chain throughout the whole thing, because if something broke, then the whole thing's like, oh, it's dead, right? Right. Yeah. So they'll have different chains, and then you can pull taps off of it. Like at the middle of each row, let's pull a tap off to a BGA ball so we can do a resistance check on that. So now if this whole big chain breaks, you do a resistance on those taps and see what part of the chain breaks. And what that gets you to is if you want to go take it into the lab and slice and dice it to see what actually broke, mm-hmm. it's pinpointing you on the device where to do it. So that's what the daisy chain part of it is in the test vehicle. So the test vehicle itself is testing the whole process. The daisy chain is mainly checking the connectivities on the bumps and balls inside your subsystem.
Sounds pretty complicated. Who is actually responsible for creating these test vehicles?
So if you're the manufacturer and you're going to say, I'm going to guarantee this, mm-hmm. the manufacturer would probably make the test vehicles. You know, if they're having it in a process and you know, they're saying we're guaranteeing that we can run the 12 and 12 spacing with an 80,000 pin die or something like that, they're going to make their own test vehicles probably to go test out that process. But as you and I know, technology pushes everything, right? So we're making a product. We've got 120,000 pin die. The manufacturer might not guarantee that, oh, that's 100. I'm not so sure about that, right? So then it might be left to the actual customer to go off and make a test vehicle. And that die, that it's just a dummy die, right? The die just has an RDL layer with the connections across it. But I see both the OSATs making them, customers making them, you know, the foundries making them, just to test out all those processes. The actual person responsible for doing it, though, is just your typical layout, engineer. You know, whoever's going to be probably laying out the product, they're the ones that are actually going to be doing the test vehicle.
Gotcha. So how do test vehicles factor into that relationship between the OSATs and the OEMs?
I see both. The manufacturers themselves, when they're going through it, and I don't know whether I can mention names or whatever, but one of our large customers probably makes 10 to 12 test vehicles for every product they make. So they're going off and making their own test vehicles to make sure that they've worked out all the bugs in manufacturing across this, you know, whether they're testing the bumps and balls and things like that. And then the customers themselves that are pushing the technology, like I mentioned before, if they have embedded parts or, you know, any kind of chiplet, so you have this die-to-die interface. Well, a lot of times we don't route that die-to-die interface on the substrate directly. We use a silicon bridge. Mm-hmm. So that silicon bridge is flipped over with the pins up. And then as your ASIC and your HBM come down, they basically index off that bridge. So now you have this, you know, in an organic material, you have a silicon bridge talking die-to-die. I don't know how they do that. You know, you got this thing sticking up and you've got these two huge parts coming down and they've got to meet this bridge perfectly to right to make this connection going across. You're going to make sure you have a test vehicle in there to make sure that manufacturing process for that is working. Well, if you had a live chip, how would you do it? You'd have to run it at speed, run the memory and everything else. Whereas if you had a test vehicle that's just checking the connectivity through the bridge, back across, through the bridge, back across. Now, real quickly, you can go off and say, you know, did this bridge make it or not? You know, are we doing it correctly? And it's as manufacturing changes, you know, like they found a better way of doing something, they might go back to that test vehicle and say, hey, you know, we've already got this dummy die with the pins on it already connected together. Let's go make one of those and make sure that this is still working out correctly.
Sounds kind of familiar. Having spent decades, as you know, on the PCB side myself, why don't we see test test vehicles in PCB design?
We actually do. I mean, they do test vehicles for PCBs, but PCBs, you know, have become more of a commodity, right? And they're not pushing technology as much as like the 3D IC space is. I mean, it, 3D IC space right now is the Wild West, right? It's, you know, each company is doing their own thing there. But for PCBs, they absolutely do. I remember I was working for General Electric and we did high power for locomotives. And we had these inductors that we were putting on the board and I was the librarian, right? Mm-hmm. So I made the part I made the holes, the pads for the part to put the inductor back in. I made them too small. We were getting cold solder joints. Mm. You know, where'd we find that? Production. You know, mm-hmm. Is that the best place to find stuff? No. You know, so in theory, when you add a new part like that, you probably need to have some kind of a test vehicle to make sure that what you're making is actually, you know, going to work, especially for high production. So companies like Motorola and Ericsson and Nokia and things have made, you know, for their phones, when they did wacky things, they would make a test vehicle to test things out to make sure that what they were doing is what they actually wanted, you know, because they were pushing technology for the space and everything at the time and in the phones, shrinking everything. It was similar to what we're doing now in the IC space, right? You know, we were, you had this brick phone and now it became this flip phone, right? But now it's the same thing. We have all these dies and HBMs or memories that are separate. We're pulling them all together on a substrate. And, you know, the technology for that is still, I'm not saying it's brand new. I'm just saying companies are coming up with more ideas than what can be manufactured right now.
Wow. Do test vehicles contain more than simple daisy chain structures?
Yes. The basic function is that chain, which is a resistivity. So they, you know, it would be like they'd have a four wire connection on them. So you have a voltage and a current to get the resistance, right? So you have a four wire, two at each end, so you can measure the resistance across the chain. Well, the problem with that is like if you're, you know, like I said, when you're running something, we're expecting the corner balls to probably break. Why do they break? Because of the temperature coefficient difference between the die and the substrate. So there's other things they add on to the substrate. They call them heaters, which to me and you, it would look like tuning patterns, right? But they're going to put a voltage across that so that pattern heats up. So it heats up the whole substrate. So now they're you know, they're trying to put something in there to mimic, you know, this under load and things like that. So you've got these heaters they'll add into the substrate itself to try to heat it up. And the other thing, they'll actually put in like these comb structures where, you know, they don't touch, but it comes kind of like this where the combs come in. They're looking for like capacitive discharge because, you know, they didn't clean off all the flux or something off the device when they did their mounting process and things like that. What's left residual on the design, and we can test that across this capacitive pattern. The other thing I've seen them do is stack vias. Did you do HDI design?
Yeah.
So when you have stack vias, you usually have rules on how many vias you're allowed to stack, right? Because each layer you put on has its own registration. So what I've seen them do is like on this chain, let's stack 1 to 5. So you're actually not necessarily going through the die at this point, but you're just doing like a substrate chain. And this chain, the 1 to 5 is completely stacked normally, right? They're coincident with each other. The next chain, all the vias in the stack are 5 microns off. The next chain, all the vias in the stack are 10 microns off. The next chain, they're all 15 microns off. So what they're trying to do is basically implement something that's going to basically tell them how the misregistration is going to handle. You know, how far can these vias be off from each other before they actually start losing connectivity or something like that? And there's other chains inside, you know, other device, things like that, that they use in the design, because it's all to test something new that you're doing, some kind of a new technology or whatever. If I can stack vias, that's huge. I mean, that saves so much routing space rather than having a dog bone on one of those layers to move over and go down, right? So I'd love to be able to stack everything, but you can't. In the same way, a lot of the substrates have a core, which is much thicker than the buildup layers on either side. Mm-hmm. Can I stack a via on top of the core via? You know, the core via is getting filled. How much of a reliability do I have if I stack the via above and below the core? And a lot of times you're putting multiple vias because the core via is pretty big, right? So you might have four vias on top of that. You're basically making that chain because somebody came to you in the last design and said, hey, we could only stack three layers. You just doubled the size of my design. I have the same amount of layers with twice as many signals. How are we going to fix this? Oh, let's stack some more vias. Well, if you want to go do that, you better go prove that you can actually make it when you go do it. So again, it comes back to let's make a test vehicle to test it.
Wow. This is one of a deep dive into the technical you know, characteristics of what we've been talking about with 3DIC. It's been great, you know, to get these visualizations and taking some notes here. Like, testing is essential for reliability and quality assurance. Risk mitigation is something you'll care a lot about. Performance verification.
Yep.
Cost efficiency is a big deal. And ensuring regulatory compliance. Is that any part of this?
On the regulatory, it would be in automotive. Automotive okay. has real stringent things on like creepage and you know, I dealt with a lot of that on the locomotive because, you know, what are locomotives? Well, they were the first electric car, right? It's a diesel engine driving a, you know, an electric vehicle or whatever. So we were dealing with battery voltages. And when you got DC voltages that high, creepages come into it. Yeah. So if you're going to go do something, you're going to do a BHAS test on it, right? You're going to do basically the stress test that you're going to put it in the chamber and do the humidity, the heat, the shake and vibe on it and everything else. A test vehicle is an excellent way to see whether something passes or not without having a device that's running, right? How are you going to tell when something's breaking if you have like the actual device in there? When you've got a daisy chain and you're just measuring a few resistance points on it, but everything's connected in the chain, boom, you've got it. You know, you can even measure resistance between one net and another net. You know, did we get creepage between these? So yes, you know, regulatory kicks in, you know, especially the automotive market. They're pretty stringent.
Yeah, this has been great. Great conversation. Any final comments you'd like to add before we close this podcast?
It is still an emerging technology. I see customers doing daisy chains, you know, by hand, you know, because when you have a chain and you have a net that's going between this, you can't call that whole net fret. Because if you did, what's the layout tool want to do? It wants to connect all those pins together, right? Mm-hmm. So in a chain, this net is going to be like Fred 1. The next little piece is Fred 2. The next little piece is Fred 3. I see people doing that by hand.
Oh.
You know, making their own net list and things for that, or using a spreadsheet to try to drive it. You know, there's better tools than that today. You know, if you're doing it by hand, don't. Stop. Ask for help. Somebody can help you.
Awesome. It's great. Well, thank you again for joining me today. And thanks for sharing your knowledge and insights about the necessity and importance of creating test vehicles and daisy chain design tests. That's really interesting stuff. That's it for today's episode of the 3DIC podcast. To all of our listeners and viewers, thanks for joining us today. And be sure to check out the show notes to learn more about today's topic. And also be sure to follow this podcast on YouTube or your favorite streaming service so you don't miss the next episode of the 3DIC podcast. Thanks.
Thank you, John.